What does the release of former Senator Laila de Lima reveal to you in terms of the state of the justice system in the Philippines?
So, I mean, I think the release of Laila de Lima is obviously extremely welcome news. It was really heartwarming to hear her voice. You can see the sort of strength and fortitude that she's had that has sustained her in nearly 7 years of being in police custody. That said, you know, Laila de Lima should not have spent one nanosecond in prison. And I think the fact that it took nearly 7 years to get to this point, you know, really shows us that there is something that is broken in the Philippine justice system that it took this long. Now, obviously, she's been released. That's good news. You know, the judge has said, you know, it's because, you know, he's reviewed the evidence and he thinks that the bail application should succeed. But, you know, it's not an unconditional release. And so I think, you know, we're really waiting to see what will happen now with that final pending case. And we hope that she is unconditionally released because, you know, this was ultimately, you know, politically motivated charges that she faced, and her going to police detention was really about silencing those who spoke up against the war on drugs in the time of Duterte.
And I was asking the senator this question, and even the former Senate president, is the fact that given we're a democratic society, and yet it seems that the executive has so much influence on the justice system when it's supposed to be three independent, separate statutes in a democratic society, right? You have the executive, legislative, and the judicial that's meant to be independent. But in the Philippines, it's proven that the executive wields a lot of influence and power.
Well, that's right. And I mean, I think we have to, you know, step back a bit and remember that, you know, at the time when Laila de Lima, you know, was first arrested, this came after a very vile, misogynistic campaign by President Duterte, who even vowed, you know, and was caught on camera saying, you know, I will destroy you. And then what we saw was three different cases brought. Two of the cases have now been thrown out because, you know, witnesses have recanted their testimony. The third one is still being considered. So this is still a live case. But I think it is really concerning, actually, that Laila de Lima had to spend so long in police custody. And I think the fact that this happened to someone who, you know, was a senator, who was a former minister of justice, a former president of the Human Rights Commission, I think it really was to send a message to journalists, to activists, to anyone in the Philippines who was speaking up against the drug war at that time, that if we can do this to a senator, just imagine what we can do to you.
And where are you seeing, I mean, in the Human Rights Watch report, this is a January 2023 report, the HRW report reveals that the human rights situation in the Philippines has hardly changed. That was the January Human Rights Watch report. Is it still the same today, or with the release of Laila de Lima, will this affect the Philippines' standing in that report?
Well, I think this is a positive, significant step. But what we're really, you know, hoping to see is genuine change. And that means that the killings by law enforcement of drug users needs to stop. And frankly, you know, since the Marcos administration took power, we've still continued to see hundreds of such killings. The numbers have come down from the time of the Duterte administration, but it is really concerning to see that that continues. We've also seen an increase in the red tagging of activists, so leftist-leaning lawyers and trade unionists. And so this is concerning. So I think what we hope to see to show that this is different is that there is investigation and prosecution of those who perpetrated these killings.
But are you seeing more red tagging today under this administration?
We have seen more cases of red tagging. Yes, under this administration. And I think that is really concerning to see that there have been more cases, of people who, are working in different communities. They may have been raising environmental issues. They may have been representing Indigenous people. And in some cases, they've been threatened, they've been harassed, they've been intimidated. In some cases, they've had to, go into hiding. And in the worst cases, people have wound up killed. And so, this is really concerning that we continue to see that happen now. And so we continue to call on the Marcos administration to end the red tagging of activists. This was something that was actually raised by President Biden when he welcomed President Marcos to the White House. So this is something that has been raised by foreign governments. And this is also something that the UN and other organizations are also paying very close attention to.
All right. Now, what's quite interesting in it, what's revealing actually is the fact that the state of the democracy of a country, where specifically the Philippines, but let's put it to generally, a country depends on who is head of state. It's not the institution itself. Elaine, how can the Philippines move to become a country wherein the institutions are so strong and independent that regardless who is head of state, the democratic principles are upheld? Because what's disappointing in the Laila de Lima situation is that her freedom depended on an administration shift, right? I even asked the lawyer yesterday, if Duterte was still in power, do you believe she would be granted bail with the same evidence, the same situation in court? And he said no. And for me, that was the most tragic, being a Filipino citizen and a parent, having two children that I'm raising here in this country, that the justice system is completely dependent on who is head of state.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really good question, and I really think it speaks to the weakness of institutions in the Philippines, the fact that the courts can be prone to political capture and used in this way, in order to basically, allow politically motivated investigations and prosecutions of people who criticize the government. Now, I mean, we've seen the damage in other countries, in democratic countries, such as the United States, that can happen when you have, a president that actually doesn't care about human rights. But I think, it really speaks to what is the strength of the institutions to provide that ultimate check on power in a democratic country. And so I think this is actually where we need to see further progress in the Philippines. We really need to see the independence and the strength of those institutions so that the courts can be a check on power in order to prevent, these sorts of politically motivated cases from progressing.
All right. My last question is, you've seen the difference of both administrations, the Duterte administration and now the Marcos administration, in terms of policy or implementation. I don't think the PNP is practicing now Oplantokang, and yet it could be in another name or another form or just systemic. But what kind of specific changes would you want to see so that the Philippines really improves its standing when it comes to human rights?
Well, I think what we'd like to see is investigation and prosecution of law enforcement officials who've been implicated in drug war killings. And that, frankly, is something that we've only seen in a tiny handful of cases where there has been massive public outrage, cases where effectively police officers were, caught on film. But we know that under Duterte, there were, thousands of such killings, anywhere from 9,000 to, perhaps as high as 20,000 such killings. So that's what we're really looking for to show that there is a shift. It's not enough that the number of killings have reduced. We really need to see this accountability. And ultimately, I think that's what, the International Criminal Court has continued its investigation into these abuses, precisely because there hasn't been sufficient accountability for these killings. And so that's really what we're looking to see.
Will it change the standing of the Philippines? My last question, with President Marcos Jr.'s statement, I mean, if the Philippines welcomes the ICC, because last year the president did say that the ICC is only welcome if the system collapses. Early this year, it was the tone was quite similar. But how different would it be if this administration welcomes the ICC?
Well, I think that would be a very welcome development, frankly, because, you know, whether or not the Philippine government cooperates, the ICC will continue its work. And it's made that very clear. It has said earlier this year that the investigation will proceed. And so I think the Philippine government, this administration, should show that, you know, it's willing to cooperate, and that it does value justice and accountability and many of the things that many Filipinos indeed hold dear. And just a few months back when I was in the Philippines, I met with widows, I met with women who'd lost their children to the drug war, and they were very concerned that there has been no accountability for these cases. They were too afraid to take their cases to the police because they were afraid of further repercussions. And so I think, what do we say to the victims who lost their loved ones during the drug war? They want to see some form of accountability moving forward. And I think the Marcos administration really owes that to the victims of the drug war killings.
On that note, I want to thank you so much, Elaine Pearson of Human Rights Watch, for this interview this morning. I know you're live from Perth right now in Australia, so thank you for joining me.
Thanks so much for having me on.